It's really an honor to get to introduce Wil Haygood this afternoon. He's not only, as you surely know, a respected veteran journalist and an acclaimed author, but he's a great friend of Politics and Prose, and we're really thrilled to be able to host the launch event for his new book, which is just out this week. Showdown is the narrative of Thurgood Marshall and his dramatic hearings that ensued back when Lyndon Johnson nominated him as a candidate to be the first African-American Supreme Court justice. Through the lens of the 5 days of Senate hearings that presaged his confirmation, Haygood gives us a compelling portrait of the subject while also capturing the climate of the civil rights moment at that movement at that moment in time. This is an important book about a transformative figure, but it's also notable as part of Haygood's own impressive body of work, which now includes biographies of Adam Clayton Powell, Sammy Davis Jr., Sugar Ray Robinson, and also of the White House butler Eugene Allen, which began as a Washington Post magazine article and was transformed into a movie starring Oprah Winfrey. We had such a huge audience for Will when he spoke here for that book that we nearly had a stampede when it was time for him to sign books. So let me just take this moment to tell you that after the event, we're going to form a signing line in this direction and this direction only. And we have books behind the register, so please pick one up after the event. But for now, please help me welcome Wil Haygood.
Oh, wow. Thank you all for coming out today on such a nice fall. Okay. Now, can you hear me? Better? Well, thank you all for coming out today on such a nice fall evening. Susan, thank you. This is my favorite bookstore in the whole world, from here to the left bank of Paris. This is my favorite bookstore, and you're my favorite posse. I spent 5 years on this book, learned a lot. And met a lot of interesting people. One of the very poignant things about doing a book like this is, you know, you'll go and you'll interview someone and who knew Thurgood Marshall, and you'll open up the newspaper 3 or 4 months later, and you'll see that they passed away. And so there were a lot of people who I met during the research of this book who are no longer here. And I like to think of the book as kind of a tribute to those who worked alongside Thurgood Marshall and who are no longer here. And I'm going to read a little section about two or three little sections. The first section takes place inside the White House, and I think it'll speak for itself. The U.S. Supreme Court, since its founding, had always featured white justices. A Negro had never even been seriously considered. Even as President Johnson was fighting a war in Vietnam, it was race that truly haunted and tore at the fabric of a nation. On the morning of June 13, 1967, Lyndon Johnson gathered some key members of his staff in the Oval Office. Among them were the aides Marvin Watson and Clifford Alexander. Also, there was Thurgood Marshall, who had been a federal appeals court judge and was the current Solicitor General, as well as Louis Martin, a White House political advisor. Martin had known Marshall for years and looked upon him with an enormous amount of reverence. A Negro butler served light refreshments to the small gathering. There was a feeling around the room of heightened emotion mixed with swooning, especially by all the blacks present. The president was going to nominate a Negro to the U.S. Supreme Court. He told no one save a very few close aides. He was not going to be talked out of it. "I want to do this job that Abraham Lincoln started," Lyndon Johnson had confided to a few aides about his plans. Thurgood Marshall had been considered public enemy number one in the South because of his court victories upending many of the laws of segregation. With Johnson's nomination of Marshall, it was as if he were hammering the final nail into the coffin of white supremacy. "Thurgood," LBJ said to Marshall, "I'm nominating you because you're a lot like me, bigger than life, and we come from the same kind of people." There had never been a president with the kind of ease around Negroes that Lyndon Johnson possessed. Johnson knew how much it meant to Louis Martin to be in the White House on this day. Johnson finally rose from the sofa after ordering Marshall to phone his wife, Sissy, and inform her of what was about to happen. Johnson began to lead the group outside. Louis Martin was an emotional sort. He had desperately wanted to get a job on a major newspaper after taking his degree from the University of Michigan in 1934. But major newspapers were not hiring blacks. He wound up in Cuba, writing freelance articles before returning to America and editing a small Negro newspaper. Whenever he'd run into Marshall at airports, train stations, Chicago or Harlem barrooms, they'd get to reminiscing about all the things they'd seen: chain gangs, segregated movie theaters, all-white police departments. They'd get to recalling those restaurants that made them go around the back just to get a sandwich. Now this, a Supreme Court nomination. Louis Martin was so sentimental that he would often cry when there was some kind of exalted black achievement to celebrate, big tears just welling up in his eyes. As Lyndon Johnson began to speak alongside Thurgood Marshall, Louis Martin began sobbing, quietly, and for two reasons. The first was sheer joy in how happy he was for Marshall. The second reason was worry and fear. He knew how difficult the looming battle for confirmation was going to be. When Johnson and Marshall finally emerged from the White House, walking toward the Rose Garden in the bank of microphones, members of the press suddenly looked up. Some squinted to see more clearly against the glare of sunlight as the hum of whispering started. When Marshall himself was unmistakably spotted just over the president's left shoulder, the air filled with heightened curiosity. Reporters started jockeying for better positions. Photographers raised their cameras. There was a feeling something profound was about to happen. This next section involves some letters. I spent a lot of time at the Lyndon Johnson Library out in Texas. And I came across a box of letters, and as far as I know, they've never been published. And these letters, they all pertain to the nomination of Thurgood Marshall. The letter from Calhoun Road in Magnolia, Arkansas, was written on behalf of the entire family. Please, Senator McClellan, no nigger on the Supreme Court bench, with looting and burning and riots all over the country, and LBJ conscious only of votes. So many here feel as we do. Please do not confirm. Sincerely and best wishes, the Harshaw family. Senator John McClellan was an arch segregationist and convinced himself that he was going to do all he could to stop Thurgood Marshall from reaching the U.S. Supreme Court. There was another letter that I came across, and it was on my last day in Arkansas, where I had went to look through the papers of Senator John McClellan. He was a segregationist. I started the book in 2009, in late 2009, and 45 days after I started research, John McClellan's papers were finally opened to the public after 48 years. I guess that's what they call timing. This letter thoroughly convinced me that I was doing the right book. It came from 2103 Delaware Street, Texarkana, Arkansas, and it was written on the second day of Marshall's hearings, July 19, 1967. Dear Senator McClellan, I am a resident of Arkansas and a law-abiding citizen who believes strongly in God, the United States Constitution, and justice for all. Recently, I read an article concerning remarks made by you and another senator about Thurgood Marshall, who is trying to become an associate justice of the Supreme Court. Sir, I am a Negro and an American. I want you to know how I feel about Mr. Marshall's nomination. I'm sure that I can speak for all the blacks in the state of Arkansas. Mr. Marshall is just as qualified as any likely candidate that you know. It has been made quite clear which side you are on. We all know why you and the other Southern senators don't want him to be on the Supreme Court, and it's not because of the U.S. Constitution. Mr. Marshall doesn't lack inequalities. You don't want him because he's black, and that is the only reason. That old song about the Constitution being misinterpreted is another excuse. The Supreme Court is not too liberal in its interpretations. If anybody is lax, it is the people. The statement was made concerning those justices who interpret the U.S. Constitution. They were referred to as activists. They were accused of adding to the Constitution things that weren't in it. Stop covering up behind some excuse. Your attack on the Supreme Court is a way of trying to get to Mr. Marshall. The members of the Supreme Court make decisions that are for the good of the people and not to suit themselves. Chances are that the nomination will be turned down. If Marshall doesn't get the nomination, there will be others who will seek it after the same opportunity when it presents itself. There will be hundreds, Senator. Somebody will get it. One of these days, the President of the United States will be a Negro. Sincerely yours, Barbara Ross. It gave me goosebumps when I came across this letter. And I'm a newspaper man, nosy, very curious. I called Texarkana, Arkansas, about 3 months ago, and I told the city clerk that I'm going to be on a book tour down in Texas, and I wanted to find an heir, a Miss Ross, a Barbara Ross, to give her family the book. And this lady said to me, I do think I know somebody who is related to Mrs. Ross. And I called a phone number, and an elderly lady answered. And I said, hello, my name is Wil Haygood, and I'm a writer, and I've been working on a book about Thurgood Marshall. And I'm looking for anybody who is related to Mrs. Barbara Ross. And the elderly, frail voice said, well, I'm Barbara Ross. And I said, wait a minute. I'm looking for the Barbara Ross who lived in Texarkana in 1967. And she said, that would be me. And just to be sure, as I read you the address at the beginning of the letter, 2103 Delaware Street, I said, Mrs. Ross, can you tell me your street address in the summer of 1967? She said, of course. It was 2103 Delaware Street. She was 20 years old. She was a college junior. Her professors were very nervous that she was going to write the senator this letter. She was very brave, and she touched me deeply. We've talked several times on the phone, and I'm going to be paying her a visit when I'm on my book tour out in Texas. She had said to me, she said, now, when you started talking, you had mentioned this movie, The Butler. I love that movie. Can you tell me how you got involved in it? one of the sweetest things that I found out, that on the day of Marshall's nomination, there were three black butlers in the White House, and one of them was Eugene Allen. His son, Charles Allen, is here, and I'd like him to stand up. Charles Allen, son of the butler. This is the scene, yes, the hearings lasted 5 days, but they were stretched over 14 days. So you can imagine Thurgood Marshall, he goes home and he gets a call from one of the aides to one of the segregationist senators who says, the hearings tomorrow are going to be canceled. We found out something by the FBI that we don't like, and we need more time to look into it. You can imagine the fear, just the sheer fear that put into Thurgood Marshall. And so, and then the riots happened in Detroit on the last day of the hearings, and it really was rocky for him. He was very worried. And this is the scene of the vote and a little bit of the aftermath. White House aides had been tabulating numbers in the days leading up to the vote. While a nominee requires 50 votes to pass, the important number for the White House was 60 votes, the number needed to avoid a filibuster, told in the days leading up to the vote that they did have those 50 votes, enough for confirmation, Johnson was focused on the 60 votes needed to stop a filibuster. If the Southerners managed to stop Johnson at 60 votes, they could filibuster the nomination into oblivion, and LBJ knew it. With the turmoil in the streets, he simply could not afford a filibuster. And that is what he told those senators on the other end of his phone calls. Strategically, he courted Southern senators who listened to him when he urged them to not vote. Because if they did not vote, their votes would not show up in the figures to be released to the public. The White House counted a tally of 69-31, only 9 votes beyond a filibuster. But the no vote count of 31 was not a figure Lyndon Johnson wanted to present to the country, which is why he kept hammering Southern senators to not vote. After 6 hours, it was finally agreed that there would be no more delays. The time had come to vote. Senator Mike Mansfield, the Senate leader, opened the voting, and soon there were the echoes throughout the chamber. Aiken, yay! Anderson, yay! Byrd, nay! Eastland, nay! Hill, nay. Sparkman, nay. Church, yay. Lawshy, yay. Pell, yay. Symington, yay. Thurman, nay. Some of the votes were uttered in even monotones, while others soared high in volume, causing necks to crane throughout the galleries. Kennedy, yay! Long, nay! When it was all over, the final tally showed 69-31. LBJ and his White House aides had prevailed to make a vote that could have been 69-31 actually turn into 69-11. Thurgood Marshall was going to the U.S. Supreme Court. Phil Hart, a senator from Michigan who had floor managed the vote, nearly wept. A huge smile crossed his face. All the senators who had fought for Marshall began reaching out to one another to shake hands. They had made history and they realized it. Senator Mansfield could not hold back his emotions. He glanced around the Senate from side to side. They all set their eyes upon him. Then he spoke in a voice clear and strong. Mr. President, the confirmation of the nomination of Thurgood Marshall as an Associate Justice of the Supreme Court is also a confirmation of the vitality of the democratic system. It is a tribute to the good sense of you, Mr. President, who made this nomination, and to the judgment of the Senate, which approved it. The confirmation means that a man who loves the law and who has a firm respect and high faith in it moves to the top of his profession by entering the highest judicial body in the United States. Thurgood Marshall's rise to the Supreme Court reaffirms the American ideal that what counts is what you are and not who you are or whom your antecedents may have been. This is a shining hour, Mr. President, for Thurgood Marshall, for you, for the Senate, and for the United States of America. We have come a long, long way toward equal access to the Constitution's promise. I join my colleagues in the Senate in extending sincere congratulations to Mr. Justice Marshall, on this most auspicious day in his life. A short while later, word reached the newest member of the U.S. Supreme Court that he would have to report to be measured for his judicial robes. This last scene is about Marshall, who seemed to have fallen out of favor for some reason or lost in the limelight of his country. Which should not have happened. One of the sweet things I found out was that toward the end of his life, Lyndon Johnson, who was sickly and who was back on his Texas ranch, had made a phone call one night to Thurgood Marshall and reached him at home. And Lyndon Johnson said, "Thurgood, the hell you put me through in getting you onto the court. It was hell." And he said, "But I'm calling you because I've decided to write a book about the confirmation process. And I want you to help me." That was Lyndon Johnson sounding like William Shakespeare. "I'm going to write a book." "Yeah, sure." And Thurgood Marshall, sounding like James Baldwin, said, "Hey, I'm going to do everything I can to help you." Lyndon Johnson died a few months later, and they never got to write. He never got to write that book with Thurgood Marshall. When I told my 24-year-old niece that story, she said, "Well, Uncle Will, you wrote the book that the president wanted to write." Hey, I said, "That's a nice line. That's true. I might use that on my book tour." My beautiful, wonderful little niece told me that. Anyway, this is this last scene. Artists and organizations had long been taking note of Thurgood Marshall's historical import. In 2008, the gifted actor Lawrence Fishburne opened on Broadway at the Booth Theater in Thurgood, a one-man play which told of the justice's sweeping life. Visitors to San Francisco's Grace Cathedral could look up at the Human Endeavor windows and see all the windows that were named in honor of heroic figures in their craft. Albert Einstein, natural science, had a window. So did Jane Addams, social work. And Robert Frost, letters. Thurgood Marshall's window, law, like the others, set high up in the cathedral nave. The church would only grant you a window if it had accepted you into the realm of sainthood. On his editorial page on March 6, 2011, the New York Times penned an editorial simply titled "Thurgood Marshall." It was unusual on that page to have a life revisited after the passage of so much time. It was a lovely and tender tribute about the ongoing artistic homage being paid to Marshall's life. On the Supreme Court today, the editorial stated, "There is no justice who seems similarly placed there to speak for the powerless by such a sweeping tide of history. There is no one whose life translates so magisterially into art." All of the attention gained Marshall new admirers. Tourists would troop out to Arlington National Cemetery to visit his gravesite. The cemetery sat on land once owned by a prominent Confederate family. After the Civil War and the South's defeat, the land would be sold to the federal government. Old and bent in jubilee singing Negroes, fresh from the slave plantations, would trudge into Washington without places to stay, hoping their government would help them. Many who were penniless were reduced to foraging for food. They were often given housing on the site of the cemetery itself, a part of which was called Freedman's Village. These were the very people whom Secretary of War Edwin Stanton had appealed to for help during the massive manhunt to bring President Lincoln's assassin to justice. And when the final gust of breath had left the former plantation residents, they would be placed in spare wooden coffins and lowered into the earth on the same grounds where Thurgood Marshall, who had worked to free their descendants, would be laid to rest years later, allowing the wind to blow eternally over their gathered souls. Thank you. So I guess we have
on either side if you wanna step up.
Hello?
Yes.
I've heard it said, I'm not an expert, that Thurgood Marshall on the Supreme Court didn't deliver quite the expected performance. I don't know whether that's the case or even whether he found it rather dull after the life he'd led, but could you comment on this?
Whole lot of dissents, you know. I don't like what the rest of the court is doing, you know, and so the Supreme Court that he served on for 20 plus years was psychologically and spiritually out of step with his beliefs. They cut back affirmative action, and they cut back women's rights, and they cut back the rights of criminals, just right down the line. And so he was not a happy man on the court. I knew going into this book that I did not want to write about his 20 plus years on the court. So that's why I focused on things that came before he reached the court, and focused on the 5 days of his hearings. But his mind was still sharp. Super dissents, I mean, they are worth reading. I mean, they are just sharp-edged, you know. They're full of Marshall's vinegar in his blood. He was fighting for the voiceless. And so his career on the court was stellar. It was just dimmed by the ferocious opposition that he, you know, that he faced.
Thank you.
Okay.
Could you talk about how he felt about being nominated?
He was 59 years old when he was nominated, and I think Marshall, you know, many people have told me this. He was not the most humblest person. And I think it was simply because he had fought so much for his country, and his life had been threatened. He had been arrested. And when Robert F. Kennedy offered him a federal judgeship in 1961, he said, "You got to be kidding. That's beneath me. Federal judgeship, that is beneath me." And so Robert F. Kennedy said, "Well, you accept this or it's nothing. You cannot turn down the president. So you accept this or it's nothing." And Thurgood Marshall said, and the scene is in the book, Thurgood Marshall said, "You don't seem to understand. I've always had nothing." And so they came back and gave him a federal appeals court judgeship. You know, and so he's a very dignified man. And so did he jump up and down and hoop and holler when he got the nomination? No, he did not. He knew he was more than qualified. Yes.
Mr. Hager, thank you for writing this. I read the book Devil in the Grove,
mm-hmm.
and I had no idea that Florida was that ferocious with... Oh. Thank you for writing this. I read the book Devil in the Grove about Thurgood Marshall and what he was going through.
Yeah.
And I would like to do anything I can to help you make this into a movie, and also that Thurgood Marshall should have a national holiday. What he did was unprecedented and phenomenal. I ran into Lyndon Baines Johnson's daughter at a fundraiser, and I told her how thankful I was of what her father had done. I don't know where we would be if Thurgood Marshall had not put forth the civil rights and the school education and everything that he did. I have a 15-year-old daughter here with me today, and I wanted her to come see you and meet you.
Oh, great.
And understand where we would be had it not been for Thurgood Marshall.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw the movie Rosenwald,
uh-huh.
and how there was just things.
Yeah, it's a great movie.
It was incredible. I didn't
very
know
touching. Yes.
What he had done to help blacks. But I just hope I can talk to you afterwards, because that really should turn into a movie.
Thank you.
And go even bigger.
Well, I would think that that a movie done right, like Lincoln, mm-hmm. Would probably cost about probably $30 million. So if you got that, $30 million in your your pocket, then we can rock and roll.
I own a compost company. I recycle food waste for grocery stores, so I'm working towards that. Would we have to speak to President Obama about making that a national holiday, his birthday?
Yeah, you know what? Write letters. Where is your daughter? Is she here?
Yeah, she's
tell her to come up here. Where is she at? Can you come up here for a minute?
She's
shy?
No, we've... I'll tell you later.
Oh, I've been
teenagerness.
Hi. Who are you? Say it again. Spell that.
Jane Nicole.
Okay. My best friend in high school, Steve Flanagan, he lives in Chicago. He always makes me, like, you know, special gifts or something when one of my books comes out. He always does it. And he had these ink pens made, and they say Showdown, Thurgood Marshall by Wil Haygood. And I bought one tonight for somebody special. And so here you go. You're welcome. Thank you. Okay, you and I talk. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
She fought me. She didn't want to come.
Oh, my goodness. I'm glad she came.
Okay.
This is Aviva Kempner, whose movie I just saw 3 nights ago.
Oh.
Rosenwald. Right down the street. It is a beautiful, beautiful movie. Thank you for making that movie.
And I told everyone to buy your book. You know, we live in D.C., and there's a place called the Thurgood Marshall Center, which mm-hmm. in making the film on Julius Rosenwald, it was the first Y that he supported. He supported 28 African-American Ys, and if you go in there, you can go right in
yep.
and go around. There's wonderful photographs all around, because Justice Marshall did a lot of his research for his cases there.
There, right.
And
it's beautiful.
Do you know more about that? And then also Charles Hamilton Houston, who took some footage that's in my film, who's also very key to these desegregation cases.
Yes.
Do you want to talk about their relationship? Because Houston also fascinates me in terms of the work they did.
Yeah. Thank you. Houston, great lawyer. He taught at Howard. He was Marshall's mentor. He went on a trip down south shortly after Marshall finished college. And Houston, he's a very elegant, suave figure. He took Marshall along, much like Truman Capote took Nell Harper along, somebody to fight for him. Truman took Nell Harper if he got in a fight, you know, when he went out to Kansas, and Houston took Thurgood Marshall. And they went down south taking notes about, you know, the Whiggett school conditions for students down there. And it was a great, nearly like a father-son thing between them. Just two giants. Houston died
too young.
Young, though. He had a massive heart attack, and he was so young. It was just so sad, but he was a brilliant man.
And he took footage to document that.
Yes.
I'm able to use in the film. So, but
yes,
go over to the Thurgood Marshall Center. It's really a wonderful
yes.
place.
Thank you, Aviva.
On 12th and U.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you, Aviva. Thank you for your film, too. Yes.
Hello, Mr. Haygood. I'd like to thank you for writing the book. I heard that during Thurgood Marshall's tenure, that he was never invited to any white universities to give a commencement speech. I don't know how valid that claim is. But I could see why, him being on the bench, he must have been extremely frustrated in not getting the other, his associates, to see that the nation needs to move in a positive direction. So I could understand why. Do you see any similarities between Thurgood Marshall and Eric Holder? Because I think Eric Holder is the kind of attorney general that we need for this modern America.
Yeah. You know? Marshall's life, I think, now means more than ever with Baltimore, Freddie Gray, that's Marshall's hometown, Ferguson, Staten Island, Florida, all these incidents happening, unarmed black people being shot, mass incarceration. Marshall, he was talking about that when he was on the bench, mass incarceration. He was talking about that now. Now it's vogue to start talking about it. I mean, we have too many people locked up. Now, that's not to say that there aren't a whole lot of people in jail who certainly should be there. But there are a lot of people for minor drug offenses, you know, serving 2, 3, 4 years who probably shouldn't be there. And it just saps money from the communities. It fractures families. There is a good article on the cover of the New Atlantic, which is about black families who have members locked away. It's the October issue of the Atlantic. I have memorized that because there's a fabulous review in that issue of Showdown.
All right.
Fabulous. Two whole pages. In the title of the review online, actually, they didn't use it with the print version, but the title online is Thurgood Marshall, Badass Lawyer. That is a great, yeah, look it up, read it. Or maybe you can buy, no, don't buy the Atlantic, buy the book. Yes.
And I think she was next.
Okay. Okay.
It's a question about the confirmation process itself. How politically acrimonious was it? Did it reach into personal issues, such as what we've seen in subsequent hearings mm-hmm. since that time?
Well, yes. Good question. The hearings were ruled over by four arch segregationists: James Eastland of Mississippi, Sam Ervin of North Carolina, Strom Thurmond
of South Carolina,
mm-hmm. and John McClellan of Arkansas. So they allowed Marshall to have no witnesses, people who might have said, oh, he saved my son from being sentenced to 50 years for a crime he didn't do. I mean, they allowed no witnesses. Up until 1967, the longest any nominee had ever been grilled was a day. And often it was just 2 hours, and it was over with. Marshall's, by the second day, it became the longest hearing in history for a nominee. Then the third day, and the fourth day, and the fifth day. And mind you, as I said, these were not five straight days. They sometimes canceled the hearings on Marshall, and he got very, very nervous. Marshall's wife was Filipino. Mm-hmm. Strom Thurmond asked Marshall about interracial marriages. The case, Loving v. Virginia, had just been decided, whereas in the state of Virginia, interracial marriages were outlawed. Strom Thurmond did this knowing that he had a black child that he had fathered with his family's black maid. Mm-hmm. So you can see the hypocrisy that was going on there. So yes, they were very, very nasty hearings. Marshall was smeared. Marshall was a giant. I mean, you know, he had taken 33 cases to the Supreme Court. Most lawyers don't even take one. He took 33 and won 29. That's a phenomenal record. Phenomenal. And they tried to smear him every single day. They went so far to ask him questions like, name the 1834 slave codes. And Marshall was very blunt, and he said, I have no idea what you're talking about. I mean, he just looked at them like they were nuts. I mean, so yes, they were tough, tough, tough hearings. He was grilled repeatedly. And when the Detroit riots happened, Eastland of Mississippi said the night of those, because the hearings had been canceled, Eastland said, hey, now's the time to reignite the hearings while looting is going on, because Marshall is soft on crime. And now nailing to the cross on that. And so the hearings were tough for him, especially for a man of his stature. Okay? Yes.
Thank you. Again, I was here for the Butler, and it was a wonderful session, and, you know, with Mrs. Johnson and with his son. And I have your picture still in my phone. At any rate, did the FBI hearing or whatever they found, did that come up in the confirmation and was, you know, to be used against him? Because we know what they did with Martin Luther King. Mm-hmm. And did you see the FBI mm-hmm. file?
Mm-hmm. Some of it, but it's not very lengthy. Here's why. Marshall was shrewd. He befriended, of all people, J. Edgar Hoover.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Edgar, how you doing today? He became friends with Hoover. Marshall, one of the more haunting stories in the book, Marshall had two friends, Harry and Harriet Moore. Harry and Harriet Moore, they were voting rights activists in Florida. And Marshall had slept in their house. One Christmas night, 1955, Harry and Harriet Moore went to bed, and the house blew up. And it was Klansmen who had stuck dynamite underneath their home. Harry and Harriet's Moore's wife, daughter Evangeline, was here in Washington, D.C. working. And she hopped a train to go home. En route, nobody could find her to tell her, your dad has died and your mom is barely hanging on. They couldn't reach her, she was on the train. When she got off the train in her small Florida town, she looked around and said, where's mom and dad? And they whispered to her that your dad is dead and your mom is hospitalized. And she said, it can't be. It just can't be. So they rushed her to her mother's bedside, and her mother said, if you're okay and if your sister is okay, I'm ready to go because I have nothing to live for now. And the doctors told the two more daughters, and they said, if your mother can hold out for 7 days, we believe she'll make it. She died on the sixth day. Mm-hmm. And there's a long chapter because mm-hmm. I was able to find her, and she lives out in rural Maryland. And here's how much Evangeline Moore feels about what happened. So I'm sitting in her living room, and I'm talking to her from about 9 in the morning till about noon. And before I get ready to leave, she asked me to come into her kitchen because she wants me to reach up on a high shelf that she couldn't reach. And so I said, sure. And so we walked from the living room to the dining room. And in the dining room, on the wall, there is a gigantic oil painting, not of her father, but of Thurgood Marshall. And I stop and I say, my God, Mrs. Moore, why didn't you tell me that this photograph was here? Oh, my goodness. And she said, well, one of my friends, on the day that Marshall was confirmed, one of my friends in Florida had that sent to me. And so that scene is in the book, too. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Don't wait too long to visit Mrs. Frost. The sooner the better.
Okay, yes, yes. It's going to be September, early next month. And I'll be in Texas. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm going to have time for one more question.
One more question. Hello.
Hi. Can you comment a little bit on the genesis? Can you comment a little more on the genesis of LBJ's interest in Thurgood Marshall, and then also how their relationship developed throughout the years?
Yes, yes. Great question, great question. Thurgood Marshall went to Texas in 1943 to, and all you lawyers in the room would know this, to start helping blacks vote because they were not allowed to vote in the Democratic primary. And Marshall took the case to the Supreme Court. The case is called Smith v. Allwright. Marshall won. Blacks started overwhelmingly voting for Lyndon Johnson as a young senator. No Smith v. Allwright, no Thurgood Marshall, no President Lyndon Johnson, quite likely. And so Johnson knew that, and he knew what Thurgood Marshall had done to change his state. Also, there was another great Texas case that Marshall took to the Supreme Court to force the University of Texas Law School to integrate, the Sweat case. And so Lyndon Johnson really looked up to Thurgood Marshall. But Lyndon Johnson also was a realist. And on the second day of the hearings, he got nervous and wondered if Marshall was going to make it out of the committee. And so Johnson was hell-bent on integrating the U.S. Supreme Court. So he got in touch with William Coleman, who was a renowned black Republican attorney who had also worked on the 1954 case. And Lyndon Johnson summoned William Coleman secretly to the White House and said, Bill, look now, if my man Thurgood don't make it, I'm coming after you. I don't care if you are a Republican. I'm going to integrate this damn court. And William Coleman said, well, Mr. President, goodness, I am flattered. And I don't know what to say. I love Thurgood Marshall. He's a dear friend of mine. And I want you all to work as hard as you can to make it happen. I interviewed Mr. Coleman. Goodness, when I interviewed him, he was like 91 years old and dressed in his law office, had on cufflinks and a sharp suit, you know. And he said, I have a story to tell you that don't many people know, you know. And so I had a great morning with him. But Johnson, I think he had genuine love for Thurgood Marshall, and Thurgood Marshall had genuine love for him. So is that it? Thank you, Lisa. Tom, thank you, darling.